Good morning and welcome to our special edition Good Friday podcast. It is great to be together with you, and in the next few minutes we're going to explore scripture together, and we're going to take a few minutes and celebrate communion. And in this setting, I trust that you've had an opportunity to bring your bread and juice together, those elements for that time. And so as we prepare for that in just a few minutes, we're all set to go. There are a variety of links that I'll mention as well. You'll find them down in the comments section. If you're looking on YouTube, you'll find those in our Facebook note that is linked through this particular post. And those worship songs are available for you as you kind of walk through this day as well. Also want to mention that coming up in the next couple of days, there's going to be a couple of posts for our kids. One of them is available today, and it's linked in the comments section below, as well as on our Facebook links, to be able to connect up to a special Good Friday and then Easter book reading with Val. And so we look forward to you having an opportunity to intersect with that with your kids. And as you're sharing prayer requests, let me encourage you again to share those discreetly through a Facebook private message or on our website. There's a location to be able to submit those. It says, "How can we pray for you?" And then if you click there, there's a way to submit that very discreetly. Or if you'd like to send it by email to office@kschurch.ca. I want to encourage you to share this video as often as you'd like. And it'd be great for you to give us a shout out, and thank you to those of you who have, whether you've done that on our comments section on YouTube, which is now available, or if you've done that through Facebook in the comments, or even in any other kind of private message, or just liked the post along the way as well. When I went to my grandfather's house when I was about 9 years old, I was given a Red Ryder BB gun. And the Red Ryder BB gun was something that had belonged to my uncle, and it had still been there at my grandfather's house. And so all of a sudden it was now bestowed to me. And he lived on the north shore of New Brunswick, and so his house backed up onto the Restigouche River and into that area that overlooked toward Quebec. And so as we looked out over that area, there were lots of opportunities with apple groves and cherry groves and some raspberry bushes for a young guy with a new BB gun to him to be able to play. And so I certainly took advantage of that. I was there by myself with my mom, and I took a lot of opportunity to shoot a lot of BBs out of that particular gun. Now, one of the things that kind of occurred to me is the trees were just a little bit too tall for me to be able to pick from them. So I wondered if I could maybe pick an apple with my BB gun. I never successfully hit the stem, but I know I hit a lot of apples. And I know that year my grandfather harvested quite a few apples that had BBs in the middle of them as he was cutting them up. But there was this one part of that particular story that is a part of today. And it's kind of an interesting part for me as I think about grace. And when I think about using that BB gun, there was a moment when I was thinking that I was pretty hot because I had this gun and I was able to roam around and do all kinds of things between the trees. And one day I shot it, and I kind of shot it in a way that was careless. And because I shot it in a way that was careless, in the distance I heard kind of a different noise than I'd heard previously when I had shot that BB gun. And so I followed the line of where I had shot, and what I realized that had happened is that the neighbor, Mr. Barristow, had a car in the backyard. And that car was fully in line with where I had shot that BB gun. And that little BB had gone right through the windshield of that car. Well, my heart sank, because I thought, wow, how is my dollar a week allowance ever going to pay for this? This is crazy. But I've got to do something. Do I say anything? Do I try and cover it up? Do I walk away? And of course, in the long run, I ended up owning up to it with Mr. Baristow. And it was probably later that same night, or if not the next day, that I had to have a chat with him and tell him that I had been careless with my BB gun and I needed him to forgive me. I remember to this day Mr. Baristow saying to me, "I don't want you to worry about it. I'll take care of the windshield." What a relief, because I knew I had no way to pay for what I owed. I had no way to be able to make up to him for what I had damaged. In the book of Luke, chapter 23, and specifically in verses 26 through 49, we see Luke's account of the crucifixion. And this is an account that we know from Luke's history in writing both the book of Luke and the book of Acts, that a lot of his investigation was done by personal interviews. Interviews that he held with people who were present, eyewitness accounts of what had gone on in those particular moments. And he compiled those so that they could be an account for someone who was looking on to say what had happened in the midst of this time with Jesus. And so in this account of the crucifixion, the people he's talking to are people that must have been very close to the cross, because he shares a couple of different moments that Jesus is a part of in that time that are very unique and could only have been heard if people were close to the cross. We think that he probably had an opportunity to interview Mary, the mother of Jesus, who in the account that we read and in many other of the accounts in the Gospels, she never left the side of the cross. And so in the midst of all of the chaos, this account that Luke shares with us about a thief and about a statement are very valuable for us and really help us to think a lot about grace today. The generosity of Jesus in this moment is completely simple and uncluttered and absolutely poignant for us. Now, you may be familiar with the account. There are a couple of criminals that are being crucified at the same time as Jesus. These guys are generally what you would refer to as pretty bad guys. They are fellows that they deserved the punishment that they were receiving. And ultimately, they had committed crimes that were worthy of capital punishment. And so here they were being crucified on a cross. And the soldiers are going about their business. People are hurling insults. And that's kind of an interesting concept to think about, hurling insults at Jesus. The picture is that it's like they're throwing rocks. They're just pelting him with insults in a way that is designed to break and hurt him in a very thick and deep kind of a way. And so as we look at this, this criminal whose life had not really added up to much other than what was happening at this particular moment, and he was going to be defined by this bitter ending to his life. His life so far had pushed God away. His life so far had been defined by his own sense of what he thought was right and what he thought was wrong, and then he came up against a capital moment like this. What an amazing reality that was unfolding before our eyes. With the little breath he had left in his lungs, he says, "Remember me." Now it's interesting that this thief at this point could do nothing for Jesus. He couldn't talk about his miraculous turnaround story somewhere down the road. He couldn't do anything that was of any good to make up for any evil that he had been a part of. And he couldn't even defend Jesus from the continued barrage of insults. He could only say something to the other criminal. But in that moment, someone who was far from deserving another chance, let alone forgiveness or grace of any kind, and had no way to make up for it, well, he received the grace of God. The truth of what was shared on the cross between Jesus and the thief is something that we need to be reminded of in a simple up close and personal way. Because there are moments when we think in our own minds that we need to somehow make things up for God. And, you know, when we've been involved in things, we need to make it up to Him somehow. Or that we need to clean up in order to be able to come to God and kind of get our lives in order before we do what's next. And I often hear this with people who say, you know, if I showed up at that location where God is supposed to be present, whether it's a church or whether it's at a study or something or other, boy, the place would just cave in. We think that we have to get cleaned up before we come to God. Or maybe we may underestimate our desire, or God's desire, to really connect with us. It's amazing how sometimes we need to be reminded of the beauty of that exchange between the thief and Jesus. But there's another statement that is revealed to us in the midst of this whole moment as well. Again, up close and in a place where people can hear who are close to the cross, Jesus says, "Forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing." We see this in Luke's account as well as others, and people who are going about doing their own thing, we realize that this is directed to them, the soldiers or the people that are hurling insults, throwing them in a way to break his spirit. He's even extending grace to them. The problem is, for them, they haven't realized their need and chosen to receive what God is extending to them through Jesus at that moment. They've gone about their lives to this point, and for what we know, have continued even beyond that to live their lives as if they're okay. I've got this covered. No problems. God will accept me just as I am. I'm fine with charting my own course. I am good enough, and I do not need you, Jesus. It's an amazing statement for anyone to make. But it seems like Jesus was continuing to extend grace even to those who didn't realize they needed, who thought they were okay, but in reality really did need Jesus after all. You know, it reminds us that the extravagant grace of Jesus is extended to us. And it's not just about how we could earn that grace. It's really about how we just receive it. It's freely given to us. And the hard part of that is to recognize how not to abuse it in the midst of that moment. To recognize our need of grace, but also to recognize in this account that those who thought they were good had missed a moment that was right in front of them. But yet a person who recognized their need acknowledged that and received grace. If you let it, moments like this could really make us think, couldn't they? Are there times in my life when I've pushed away from God, when I've expressed through my actions, God, I've got this. And you know what? In many ways, I don't really need what you're giving right now. I don't want your grace for this moment. I don't look for you to tell me how to operate in the midst of this time. We find ourselves in moments like that sometimes, don't we? Where we think we're good enough, or maybe we resist what God is leading us into because we think we've got this. When we really realize the good part of this particular Friday, it's about the goodness of God, and it's about recognizing our own need of redemption, the offer of grace, of reconnecting with God where we've pushed Him away and say, God, because I don't want your authority right here in my life right now, I'm going to do this my own way. I'm going to do this the way I want to do it, not what you have to say about how I should be a part of this. So when we pushed him away as the authority in our lives, we realize that in a tragic and even brutal way, the grace of God that was earned for us on the cross is what we need. And it's nothing we can earn, but it's only something we can receive. I want to take a few minutes and participate in communion together. And I trust that you've had a chance to bring your bread and juice together as you're participating with me. And in this moment, we recognize just how large the grace of God is. When we think about Good Friday, it's amazing for us to realize the cost that Jesus paid for our redemption. Now, most often when we take communion, and maybe you've got a small portion in front of you, and that's often the way we approach communion, and in no way is it a reflection of what we think of God's grace. It's just our habit. But today, in the midst of this moment, I wanted to bring a whole loaf and a whole jug of juice to just remind us that there is so much more to God's grace than maybe what we're even able to receive at a moment in time. It's overwhelming. Our bodies can't take it all in one shot. And when we realize that that is the kind of grace that is available, it can really blow our minds. It's amazing to realize the grace of God and how God longs to engage with us with His grace. He longs to engage with us with His forgiveness. Sometimes we can even take it for granted that it's always there and that it's present and it's so great. But today, we're reminded again as we explore the cost of God's grace, recognizing what it cost Jesus to die on the cross, to be abused, and to have His body broken. Like when He was talking with His disciples on the night He was betrayed, and He said, "This is My body which is broken for you." And we see in the crucifixion His body broken. And in the midst of that moment, we recognize that now, because of His crucifixion, we participate in life with Him and in His body. Let's take a moment. When He was around the table in the same way, He shared a cup. And it was a cup of celebration. It was a cup of redemption that was a part of what was happening in the Passover. And as we recognize, again, our need of Jesus, we recognize our need of Him. On that night, He said, "This is My blood, which is shed for you, to clean you, to redeem you, to receive My grace. Whenever you drink it, remember Me." Let's drink together. Jesus, we thank You for the fact that in the midst of this moment, we're reminded how much we need You, how generous Your grace is, that extends to us sometimes when we don't even realize it, and how important it is for us to receive it. We come to You today. We thank You for Your sacrifice on the cross. We know that Your gift of grace cost You dearly. And so we acknowledge today, again, our need of You. The fact that even in moments where we think everything is okay and that we've got it all figured out, that we still need You. And so thank You for Your goodness to us. And it's Your goodness to us that makes this a good Friday. In just a moment, we're going to pray together. And before we do, let me just direct your attention, if you're watching on YouTube, to the comments section where all of the links are, to Facebook, and the link that is a part of this post that will take you over to the Good Friday notes that is for April 10th, 2020. Or if you're looking on our website related to website-related info, the web weekend-related info, we'll have a connection there for you to be able to link up to Good Friday. In that, you'll find some of those links that we've talked about in times past that our worship team has shared with you, songs that are meaningful for this day, and in particular, one that we've added in that has a special connection, someone who's playing a song on YouTube, and this has a special connection for members of our worship team, and we want to be able to give you an opportunity to connect up with that. There are links to our website, and there is a prayer guide that I'm sharing with you on our website as well as on Facebook, and you'll find those there. It's a 7-day prayer guide. Some of the things that we've been praying for regularly in our podcasts are listed out there in a creative way for you to be able to track through and pray for one of those every single day. There are some connections there related to our kids ministry and online giving and signing up for our e-bulletin as well as our Cabin Kids Facebook page. So make sure you check those out in just a moment. Let's take a minute and pray together. And as I mentioned, in the news and notes section of our website as well as on Facebook, you'll find this prayer guide that I just mentioned. And so today I wanted our prayer time to really focus on being thankful for the goodness of God and the grace of God in the midst of this day. So as you're praying today, together with me, be considering what are some things that are specific to the grace of God, the forgiveness of God, the reconnection, the restoration of a relationship with Him that you are specifically thankful for on this Good Friday. Jesus, thank you for your goodness to us. You are generous to us beyond what we deserve, and we thank you for that. In the midst of this moment, we acknowledge, maybe out loud, just maybe quietly under our breath, some of the things that we are grateful for in the redemption of Jesus. God, we just thank you for the way that you're at work in us. We praise you for all of the good things that we enjoy at your hand. We recognize that every good thing comes from you. And so today, as we think soberly and wisely about what Good Friday really cost you, we thank you for being willing to follow through. We thank you for being willing to go the distance. We thank you for taking all of that for us. And we're grateful. And Lord, we don't want to just try and make it up to you. We want to show our gratitude through our lives and how our lives are lived, not only in this day, but in the days that are before us. And so help us to demonstrate the transformation that you long to continue to enact in us in a way that reflects your love and your joy and your peace and your patience, your goodness, your graciousness, your gentleness and your self-control, and how those flow out of our lives as a result of the transformation that you are bringing in us. We look to you today, and we thank you. In your name I pray. Once again, thanks for joining us here on this special edition Good Friday podcast. It's great to have you here. And if you're watching on Facebook, please give us a shout out with a hey that, or like the post or share the post in some way or another. If you're doing that on YouTube, then feel free to share with us through email or even in the comments that are listed below that are now open to you to be able to share. And we'd love for you to share this video with others so that they can have an opportunity to connect with the message of Jesus this year at Good Friday. Also want to mention prayer requests, as I've alluded to before. Thank you for the way that you're sharing those privately, either by private message or by an email message. And so those are great ways for us to be able to connect. If you go to our website, there is a space for you to be able to click and engage at that point as well. I want to say farewell, that we're continuing to pray for you. And as we are navigating this time together, I'm grateful for the opportunity to be able to come to you in this way. And I look forward to continuing to engage with you as this time unfolds. And feel free to communicate through any venue that you're aware of to be able to get in touch with us. We would love to hear from you and how God is continuing to work in your life. And I want to thank those of you who are taking time to share those ways that God is already at work already. Have a super day. And in the midst of this good Friday, to be thankful and remember the goodness of God in the midst of this day. Have a great day.